Well, good morning, everyone. I want to greet you in the precious name of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Glad you've come together as the family of God to celebrate the great things of our God. Just a couple of announcements here for you. Next Sunday will be our salute to veterans, and we have a service for that at 4 o'clock. It's a great service. Come together and be a part of that, if you would, next Sunday. Tonight, you don't want to miss this. We're going to be praying for our nation. We all know about the election. The election's coming up, and I'm sure you're tired of hearing about it. But tonight, there's something we can do. We can go before God. Instead of complain and talk to one another about this thing, we need to bring it before God and bring it into fervent prayer, corporate prayer, and just ask God for wisdom. How should we vote? How should we go through this time? And so that starts at 5:30. We will have you out of here by 6:30. Pastor Tim has a few announcements.
Okay, amen. We're blessed to have Peter and Yana with us. Would you guys just stand over here? This is Peter and Yana all the way from Russia. They've got several students with them, I think nine students with them. And they're going to be sharing in the Sunday school hour today. So we invite you to come and be a part of that. They're part of a mission. He's actually the pastor of Salvation Baptist Church in a suburb around Moscow. And it's exciting that you guys are here. We're excited to hear from you this morning. Thank you for being here. We also have at this time some introduction to new members. So if you're a part of the new member group, would you come forward? We've got some on the front row already. Come down, come forward if you can this morning. And let me introduce these great people to you. Slide down right here. I'll tell you what, I'll stand down here at this end. Come on down. It's so exciting to bring in new members to membership. These are the Anadis, Teresa and Laszlo. And this is Jennifer Weilings and Kevin and Kristen Holschwander and Bill Fletcher. And this is Ellie Lavage. So I learned their names pretty good. So now it's your turn to learn their names. It's a blessing that they're coming into membership. We have others in the second service. It's really exciting. When we come into membership, we always ask a few significant questions. So let me ask you guys corporately these questions and you guys answer them, okay? Number one, can you testify that through repentance toward God and faith in the Lord Jesus that you have experienced the forgiveness of your sins and enjoy peace with God? If so, say yes.
Yes.
Do you believe that the Bible is the inspired, infallible Word of God and the sole authority for the way of salvation? And do you take this Word of God to be your rule of faith and conduct? If so, say yes. Will you endeavor by God's help to be responsible for faithful attendance of public worship, daily reading of the Scripture, prayer, praise, and systematic giving? If so, answer yes. Are you willing to submit to the authority of Ebenezer Bible Fellowship Church and to live in keeping with the faith and order of the Bible Fellowship Church? If so, say yes. Last one, since you were born again, have you been baptized by immersion as instructed by the Word of God? If so, answer yes.
Yes.
Amen. Lord bless you. Can you welcome them to Ebenezer this morning? Amen. Amen. Okay, I'll get you guys this later, all right? Lord bless you. Please be seated.
Amen. That's really exciting. I've been asked to give one other quick announcement. Believe it or not, in 3 Sundays from now, we will be having our Thanksgiving dinner. Thanksgiving, it's hard to believe. Those of you who will be bringing things, we have pans that we will give you to put the stuff in. They're in the back in the Welcome Center. Avail yourself of that on your way out this morning. We're going to be talking about the Word of God this morning. Peter calls it the sure word of God. The psalmist says in Psalm 119, blessed are those whose way is blameless, who walk in the law of the Lord. Blessed are those who keep his testimonies, who seek him with their whole heart. The word of God was given to us by God to help us to walk, help us to live holy lives. How great and magnificent is our God. He loved us so much to provide us with his words. So let's stand and sing and praise and worship our great God. Before you do that, welcome one another this morning.
worship together.
By faith we see the hand of God in the light of creation's grand design, in the lives of those who prove His faithfulness, who walk by faith and not by sight. By faith our fathers roamed the earth with the power of His promise in their hearts, of a holy city built by God's own hand, a place where peace and justice reign.
We will stand.
We will stand as children of the promise. We will fix our eyes on Him, our soul's reward, till the race is finished and the work is done. We'll walk by faith the prophets saw the day when the longed-for Messiah would appear with the power to break the chains of sin and death and rise triumphant from the grave. Go in the power of the Spirit to the lost, to deliver captives and to preach the news in every corner of the earth. We will stand as children of the promise. We will shall prevail. For we know in Christ all things are possible for all who call upon
we will
His
stand.
Name. We will stand as children of the promise. We will fix our eyes on Him, our soul's reward, till the
we will stand.
We will stand as children of the promise. We will fix our eyes on Him, our soul's reward, till the race is finished and the work is done. We'll walk by faith and not by sight.
Romans 8, verse 1 through 2 says this: There is therefore now no condemnation for those who are in Christ Jesus. For the law of the Spirit of life has set you free from the law of sin and death in Christ Jesus. Let's reflect on this. We know we can approach the throne of Christ because of what Christ did for us. Let's reflect on this as we boldly approach Him.
Alone, somehow I stand where even angels fear to tread, invited by grips my heart, and Satan tempts me to despair. I hear the voice that scatters fear. The great I am, the Lord is here. Oh, praise the one who fights for me shields my soul eternally. And boldly I approach your throne, and blameless now I'm running home. And by your blood I come, welcomed as your own, into the arms of perfect, spotless righteousness. A thousand tongues are not enough to sing his praise. And boldly I approach your throne, and blameless now I'm running. By your blood I come, welcomed as your own, into the arms of majesty.
The precious blood of Jesus Christ redeems. Forgiven, I'm alive, restored, set free. Your majesty resides inside of me. Forever I believe, forever I believe. than righteousness. Your grace has overwhelmed my brokenness. Convicted by your Spirit, led by your word, your love will never fail. Your love will never fail. I know you gave the world your only son for us to know your name, to live within the Savior's love, and he took my place, knowing he'd be crucified, and you loved a people undeserving. Jesus Christ redeems, forgiven, I'm alive, restored, set free. Your majesty resides inside of me. Forever I believe, arrested by your truth and righteousness. Your grace has overwhelmed my brokenness. Convicted by your Spirit, led by your word, your love will never fail. Your love will never fail. 'Cause I know you gave the world your only son.
Seated. With those marvelous words of praise this morning, let's go before the throne of grace. Oh, Father, we come into your presence this morning. How amazing it is that you love us and you hear us and you've brought us to this place. So undeserving as we were born into the sea of humanity that was in rebellion against you, and yet you reached down and you loved us, and you called us, and you brought us into salvation. You've given us to be part of the kingdom of light, be a part of your family. We are your children. We talked about being able to go before the throne of grace, where angels fear to tread. You have given us access right into your throne room as your children to find grace and help in the time of need. Father, it is because of the redemption that you've given us through Jesus Christ alone. It is by his blood he endured your wrath for our sake. Our sin was placed on him. Oh, Father, this morning we are here rejoicing for such a great salvation as this. And Father, you haven't left us to wander. You've given us your Holy Spirit to convict us of sin, to help us to understand your precious holy word, there where we can live holy lives and have a profound effect on our culture with the gospel. Lord, we praise you this morning. We worship you. We want this time with you to be a precious time where we set aside everything else, all of the distractions of the week and the things that we are thinking about for later and all those things, and we want to focus on you. Father, we would ask you also to be with those this morning who are hurting. Maybe they're hurting physically, and Lord, they feel the effects of sin and decay upon these bodies. We live in a physical world that is decaying and that is passing away, and we feel those effects every single day. I pray that you would be with them this morning. Administer comfort to them. Help them physically to know that you are near to them and that you love them. And Father, we pray for those this morning that may be ailing or feeling the effects of even mental distress or spiritual distress. Father, would you meet them at their point of need? And Spirit of God, would you bring comfort upon them? We pray for those this morning who may have lost a job or looking for work, and they want to work, they want to provide for their families, and yet they're without employment. Would you provide for them? Would you provide for them a job? Would you meet their needs? Father, we would also pray for those this morning who have a wayward spouse or a wayward child, and they're cut to their heart in grief. Father, I pray that you would provide them comfort and you would bring that wayward child or spouse back home. Bring them back to you. Oh, Father, we are so dependent upon you. You tell us to bring our request before you, before the throne of grace, because we need your grace every day to go throughout our days. And Father, I pray that as we are refreshed, as we are built up this morning by your word, I pray that you would open our hearts and our minds, that we would receive it as the word of truth, as Peter says, the sure word of God. We would know it comes from you. Then you would take hold of our hearts and build them up so that we can go forth from this place and do the work of the ministry in the areas you have given us, in our workplace, in our home, in our neighborhood, that the precious gospel might go forth from these lips. Father, we pray all this in the precious name of Jesus. Amen. Again, we want to welcome you this morning. We're glad you've come to worship with us together as brothers and sisters in Christ. I ask that you take the black books at the end of the pews and you would pass them down, and there you could record your attendance with us this morning. It's very important. We elders take very seriously our shepherding responsibilities, and that helps us with that. Also in there is an outline for this morning's sermon, so please avail yourself of that. If you are new with us this morning, brand new, never been here before, they ask you to take the visitor card in the black book, and if you fill that out, put it in the offering plate or put it in the welcome center, we would greatly appreciate that. Please make our visitors feel welcome this morning, and make sure you greet one another when you leave this morning. Well, we're going to continue in our worship by giving back to God a portion of what he's given to us. It's a way that we return our thanks and love to God by giving some of our monies back to him. So men, come forward.
Blessed thought, oh, words with heavenly comfort fraught. Whate'er I do, where'er I be, still 'tis God's hand that leadeth me. He leadeth me, he leadeth me, by his own hand he leadeth me, his faithful follower I would be, for by his hand he leadeth me. Sometimes mid scenes of deepest gloom, sometimes where Eden's flowers bloom, by water still or troubled sea, still 'tis God's hand that leadeth me. Lord, I would clasp thy hand in mine, nor ever murmur or repine. Content whatever lot I see, since 'tis thy hand that leadeth me. He leadeth me, he leadeth me. By his own hand he leadeth me. His faithful follower I would be, for by his hand he leadeth me.
Jim. Amen. Good morning. Good to see you. Open your Bibles to the book of 2 Peter as we come to what I probably would say is one of the most important passages in 2 Peter, and may even go so far as to say this morning one of the most important passages in all of the Bible. The passage that we're going to study are the last words. Well, all of 2 Peter are the last words, but Peter reminds us this morning that these are some of the last words that he will say. And what would you say if you had the last word to say? Would you say something significant? There's some things and people in life that have said some real surprising things. Beethoven said this as he was leaving this life, "Too bad, too bad, it's too late, too late." Some philosophical last words. Da Vinci said, "I've offended God and mankind because my work did not reach the quantity that it should have reached." Surprise, surprise, all that work that he did that was so beautiful, he thought he had failed. There was some unexpected demise and some words that people would say. Jesse James, his last words, "It's awfully hot today." Surprise, I don't know if he became a Christian or not. James Dean, "My fun days are over." My fun days are over. W.C. Fields, who was an American comedian in the early 1900s, says, "I'm looking for a loophole." Well, there are no loopholes. You must know Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior. Some of the more confirming or positive statements, especially of Christians who had assurance of salvation, would be someone like Patrick Henry. You remember Patrick Henry. Listen to what he said, his last words. "Doctor, I wish you to observe how real and beneficial the religion of Christ is to a man about to die. In his will," he wrote, he said, "this is all the inheritance I give to my dear family, the religion of Christ, which will give them one which will make them rich indeed." Wow, what a great last statement. William Shakespeare had a great last statement. "I commend my soul into the hands of God my Creator, hoping and assuredly believing, through the only merits of Jesus Christ, my Savior, and to be a partaker of life everlasting, and my body to the earth wherein it was thus made. Martin Luther said a great statement, "Into thy hands I commend my spirit. Thou hast redeemed me, O God of truth." Do you remember Harriet Tubman? I love her last statement. Doesn't surprise me. "Swing low, sweet chariot. Come take me home." Well, Peter is writing his last words to us. And if you were to write your last words as the Apostle Peter, what would you say? Well, he comes and this is what he says. "I want you to pay attention to the sure word of God. It is valuable for your soul." It is valuable for your soul. It is authoritative, and thus you should believe it. Because it's authoritative and you must believe it, then oh, please pay careful attention to every bit of God's word. This morning, this passage is tremendous for us, a great benefit for us. So we're going to study this morning 2 Peter chapter 1. We're going to begin in verse 12. We're going to read down through verse 21 together and study from God's Word. If you don't have a Bible, there's a pew Bible in front of you. There in the pew, we invite you to open it up to about 1,018. And as we like to do at Ebenezer, would you stand with me in honor of God's Word as we read His precious, infallible, perfect Word of God. And let us give our hearts attention to it this morning. 2 Peter chapter 1, verse 12, the sure word of God. Peter says this, "Therefore I intend always to remind you of these qualities, though you know them and are established in the truth that you have. I think it is right, as long as I am in this body, to stir you up by way of reminder, since I know that the putting off of my body will be soon." Here's his last, you know he's about to die, "as our Lord Jesus Christ has made clear to me. And I will make every effort so that after my departure you may be able at any time to recall these things. For we did not follow cleverly devised myths when we made known to you the power and the coming of our Lord Jesus Christ, but we were eyewitnesses of His majesty. For when He received honor and glory from God the Father, and the voice was borne to Him by the majestic glory, 'This is my beloved Son with whom I am well pleased,' we ourselves heard this voice born from heaven, for we were with Him on the holy mountain, and we have the prophetic word more fully confirmed, to which you will do well to pay attention, as a lamp shining in a dark place, until the day dawns and the morning star rises in your hearts. Knowing this, first of all, that no prophecy of Scripture comes from someone's own interpretation. For no prophecy was ever produced by the will of man, but men spoke from God as they were carried along by the Holy Spirit." Would you bow your heads with me as we pray? Father in heaven, we now come to your most holy and precious word. The pinnacle of our worship, Father, as we've gathered week after week, is to hear your voice in this inspired, infallible word of God. And Father, as the word of God is faithfully preached, we hear your voice. And Father, that's our prayer once again this week. As we come, may we hear what Peter is saying about the very precious word of God, how valuable it is, how authoritative it is, and how we as a people must listen to this written word of God. The word of God that is not the clever myths and schemes of man, but rather your perfect word, a word that's breathed out by the Holy Spirit, an inspired, infallible, authoritative word of God. May we learn and grow this morning, and may the Holy Spirit open this book to us. May this book come alive, and may we see this morning what this book is saying about itself, that it is a sure word. It's a sure word. There is no greater word for us than your word. And these very words on these very pages that we are reading are the very words of God. And may this penetrate our hearts and our lives, and may it impact us, that we may value it, that we may believe it, that we may obey it. Father, bless now as we study your word. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Thank you. Please be seated. Keep your Bibles open. There's a place for you to take notes. encourage you to take notes this morning. How important is the Word of God to you this morning? How important is God's Word to you, this written Word that we gather and study each and every week? I hope it's very important. The Apostle Peter writes to tell us, as he looks death in the face, he mentions it here, and having the Lord Jesus, we'll get to this in just a moment, but having the Lord Jesus telling him that he would die at an old age. He wants to impart, you'll remember, a truth to the disciples of Christ, that they might be established in the truth and that they might grow in the grace and the knowledge of the Lord Jesus Christ. We're entering into this little section, second part of this little book. You remember the first section was confirming our relationship with God, that we have a real relationship with God through Jesus Christ. Peter really tried to establish that in verses 3 down through verse 11. Now verses 12 to the end of the chapter, he wants to tell us if we're going to grow in the grace and the knowledge of the Lord Jesus, we must remember this. This book is valuable. This book is true. This book must be obeyed. This is the one true word for us. It is the sure word for us. And if we're expecting to grow in our faith, then certainly we must know that truth about God's Word. And so he wants to accomplish this in our lives. And he wants to do three things. He wants us, and here's the outline, it's very simple. He wants us to remember the importance of God's Word. He wants us to be convinced of the authority of God's Word. And third, he wants us to pay close attention to the Word of God. Three things, really simple. Remember what the Word of God is. Remember it. Be convinced of what it says it is, and then apply it to your life. All right? So let's look at what Peter says. So powerful for us this morning. Let's begin with number one, point number one. And we see this in verses 12 through this first little paragraph, verses 12 through 15, which is really a paragraph that we began the book with, if you remember, where Peter tells us really why he's writing the book. And this is why he says, I want you to remember something about the importance of God's Word. And if you remember the importance of God's Word, you're going to value it. That's essentially what he wants you to see here. In fact, three or four times in this little paragraph, verse 12, he says, I remind you. Did you notice that word remind? If you like to write in your Bibles, I like to circle words that are repetitive. Three or four times, I remind you, I remind you, I remind you. By way of reminder, verse 12, I want to remind you of these qualities. Though you're established in them, I want to stir you into verse 13 by way of reminder. Continue. I want you to be able to recall these things at the end of verse 15. For some reason, believers have a tendency to forget things, don't we? To forget things. And we need to be reminded of just the basic truths of God's Word. The basic truths of God's Word. And I find it interesting here as we kind of think about this for just a moment. Peter, and we'll talk highlight this at the end, Peter's not giving them something new. You should never come to church expecting to hear something new. You should come to church wanting to hear the old, old story. You should want to hear the old doctrines of the truth of God's Word. Peter says, look, I'm not coming to you like these false teachers, and we'll get to this in just a minute. False teachers are always presenting to you new ideas and new this and new that and whatever. Look, I'm writing to you so that you'll remember the old stuff. Remember what I have taught you. Remember these things. In fact, these things are mentioned several times here. These things, again, these things are the Word of God. I don't apologize, Peter says, for just stirring up your mind about what the Word of God is. I don't apologize for not sharing anything new to you. Peter was diligent just to share God's Word. And when we want to hear something new, we're going to fall into the trap of the deceivers, the false teachers. We shouldn't want to hear something new. We want to hear the great teachings of God's Word and be faithful to them. All right, so let me give you three things, because he wants us to value this Word of God, these things. He wants us to value this. And I want you to see something neat that Peter does here. He says, I want you to remember what the Word of God did for you in the past. I want you to remember what the Word of God does for you in the present. And I want you to remember something about the future of the Word of God. All right, so here's number one. Remember, first of all, that the Word of God established you. We see this very clearly. Right there in verse 12, I intended always to remind you of these qualities. And I think he's going, if you go back up to verse 8, for these qualities, again in verse, middle of verse 10, if you practice these qualities. Now in verse 12, I intend to remind you of these qualities. He's reminding us of the Word of God, putting the Word of God into our hearts. And then notice this next phrase, though you already know them. And if you're in Christ this morning, if you're a believer, you know the Word of God. You know it. You know the truths of God's Word. You know the truth that Jesus Christ was God in the flesh and that He came and that He died on the cross for us and that He was buried and that He rose again on the third day. And those who put their faith in the Lord Jesus Christ can have forgiveness of sins. These basic truths that Jesus bore our sins on the cross. All of these things, right? You know them. But notice this phrase, end of verse 12, and are established in the truth that you have. I love that. Peter says the Word of God, why should you value it? Because the Word of God did something for you in the past. It established your relationship with God in the past. Faith comes by hearing, and hearing by the Word of Christ, the Word of God. You heard the Word of God, and God opened your heart, and you received life, and you were born again. And that Word of God established you. I love this word established. It's the same word that's used in the Gospel of Luke. I don't know if you remember the story in Luke chapter 16, verse 26, that story of Lazarus and the rich man, where Lazarus goes to heaven and the rich man goes to hell. And the Gospel of Luke says that there is a chasm between heaven and hell. A chasm. This huge space between heaven and hell that is established. That is established. There's no, Abraham told the rich man, you can't go from hell to heaven because this chasm has been fixed, established. That's the idea here. No one can cross from over there to over here. The same word here is used that Peter used it. It's fixed. It cannot be moved. It cannot be moved. Now think of this. If you're established in the Word of God, you can't be moved. You can't be moved. You're firm. You're firm in your faith. You're established. It's crazy what people try to establish themselves with. The counsel of men, friendship with someone, marriage, all these kinds of things. But Peter says here, I want you to know this. Here's where you got your firmness. Here's where you were established. Now, let me ask you, do you remember when you were established? Do you remember when you came to know Jesus Christ? I'll never forget when I became a Christian. I never forget hearing the gospel when this preacher preached in Guymon, Oklahoma, just a little place. I was 9 years old. I'll never forget that place where God opened my heart and I received Jesus Christ as my Savior. And I realized I need a Savior. I'm a sinner. And in that moment, the Word of God established me. 1 Peter tells us this. 1 Peter tells us this. Chapter 1. Verse 23 tells us that we're born again through the living and abiding Word of God. 2 Timothy, you might make note of this. 2 Timothy chapter 3, verse 14, where the Apostle Paul talks to Timothy. He says, listen, I want you to continue in what you have learned. What has he learned? The Word of God. And have firmly believed, knowing whom you have believed. You've learned it from childhood. You have been acquainted with the sacred writings, which were able to make you wise unto salvation through faith in the Lord Jesus Christ. And then he gives us that great passage. All Scripture is breathed out by God, is profitable for teaching and for reproof and for correction and for training in righteousness, that the man of God may be complete, equipped for every good work. You see, this is what the Word of God does for us. And in the past, and hopefully all of us in this room can say, well, this is something that's happened to us in the past. We accepted Jesus Christ as our Lord and Savior. Now, maybe you're here this morning and that's never happened to you. We invite that to happen to you today. We ask you, we beg you, come to Jesus Christ. Listen to the Word of God, and it will establish faith in you. It will strengthen you, and it can be something of your past as well. But not only the past, but secondly, something else in the present. In the present, Peter says, I remind you of all of these things. Notice verse 13. Not only are you established in the past, but I think it's right as long as I'm in this body, I love that phrase, to stir you up by way of reminder, since I know that the putting off of my body will be soon, as our Lord Jesus Christ has made clear to me. Now, what is he saying? Well, if you remember, and we won't go here, but if you remember, and maybe just John, I can't remember if I give it to you on your outline or not, but John chapter 21, you remember Peter is the one who denied Jesus three times. He said, oh, I'll never deny you, Jesus. And you remember after Jesus had resurrected from the dead, Jesus met Peter out on the shore. And he came to Peter, and three times he asked Peter, Peter, do you love me? You remember that? Peter said, you know I love you, Jesus. First, I like you, and I love you. Jesus reestablished a relationship with Peter and forgave Peter. And I love that about what the gospel is. It's about the forgiveness of Christ. And Peter comes and forgives, Jesus comes and forgives Peter. But there in that passage in John chapter 21, verse 18, and I'll read it to you. Just listen to what Jesus said to Peter. He said, Peter, truly, truly, I say, when you were younger, you used to gird yourself and walk wherever you wished. But when you grow old, Peter, you will stretch out your hands and someone else will gird you and bring you where you do not wish to go. And then John says this, Jesus said this, signifying what kind of death that he would glorify God. Apparently, Jesus prophesied to Peter that Peter was going to die a martyr's death, that his arms were going to be stretched out. And we know that to be true. History has it that Peter was crucified upside down, refused to be crucified upright to be like Jesus. He said, crucify me upside down. Crucify me. And Peter knows that he's about to leave. That's why he says here, I'm going to stir you up by way of reminder. I think it's as right as long as I am in this body. I don't know how long I'm going to be in this body. I love that I could preach on that for a while. You know, the body is temporal. The soul lives forever, right? I hope that you know that your body's not going to last forever. Some of you have realized that more and more as the days continue on. Your body is not going to last long, right? But your soul is going to live on forever. And Peter says, look, listen, while my soul is still in my body, I want to stir you up. I want to remind you of these important things because they protect you. Now, what are they going to protect you from? Well, look over at chapter 2, verse 1. Look over at chapter 2, verse 1, and we're going to get to this next week. But here's the heart of what Peter says. False prophets are going to arise among you. They also arose among the people, just as there will be false teachers among you who will secretly bring in destructive heresies, even denying the master who bought them, bringing upon themselves swift destruction. Without going into all the details, chapter 2 lays out the character of false teachers. And he wants to stir us up. Look at chapter 2, verse 14. Look at chapter 2, verse 14. It says this about the false teachers. They have eyes full of adultery, insatiable for sin, and they entice unsteady souls. They entice unsteady souls. Underline that phrase, unsteady souls. That's why Peter is stirring us up now. Because lest we think that we are not vulnerable to false teachers, he says, I want to remind you that the Word of God is what is going to protect you in the very present, right now. Guard yourself. Don't listen to the false teachers. Rather, and we're going to get to this, listen to the Word of God. Listen to what God's Word says. Don't listen for some new thing that's being taught. Don't listen for some new revelation that some guy says, oh, put your hand over your heart and send your money and all this kind of stuff, right? Sow your seed and all this stuff that these people are telling you on TV. Look, this is going to protect you. Listen to it in the present. Here's the most important thing in your life, the Word of God. The Word of God. History has it that Peter was probably crucified by Nero in Rome. Nero was killing and murdering Christians. And now at an old age, he tells us, listen, hold on to the Word of God. Don't be brainwashed. Have some discernment. Listen to the Word of God. It will protect you. I don't have any new teachings for you. Don't listen to the words of ungodly men. Don't flood your minds with novelties and wonders. Don't become victims of false teaching. Hold on to the Word of God. That's what he says. So it has value to us, and it's important to us because it established us in the past. It protects us in the future. And then here's a third thing. It protects us in the present, but here's the future. It's going to outlast you. I love verse 15. And I will make every effort so that after my departure, you may be able at any time to recall these things. What's he saying? These things are going to outlast me. These things are the Word of God. Why do you have a Bible this morning? Because these things have outlasted every person. You know, there's only two things that last forever. Did you know that? Two things that will last forever. The Word of God and the souls of men. The Word of God and the souls of men. And Peter says, after I'm gone, you're going to have this Word, and it's going to provide protection for you. It's going to outlast me. Outlast me. All of these things are going to outlast me. The Word of God is so incredible. 1 Peter chapter 1, verse 25. Make note of that verse. 1 Peter, we've already studied this, chapter 1, verse 25. The Word of the Lord abides forever. Forever. It will never die. It will never diminish. Never diminish. It will last forever. All right, so here's what Peter says initially. I want you to value the Word of God. Do you value it? Do you remember what it did for you in the past? It established you. Established you. It's going to protect you right now in the present, and it will outlast you. This Word of God, and I'm sure Peter, I feel like Peter knew that he was writing the very Word of God. This Word is going to, it's going to last forever. God's Word is true. All right, now he wants us to move from valuing the Word of God to being convinced of the Word of God, right? To being convinced, and that's point number two. In the second paragraph now, verses 16 to the end of the chapter, verse 21, he wants to convince us that this Word that he's been talking about is authoritative. And because it's authoritative, we must believe it. We must believe it. It's not an empty faith. Sometimes people outside the world says, oh, you Christians, your faith is empty. Your faith has no substance to it. Peter is going to prove that wrong this morning as we study this passage, verse 16 through 21. He's going to give us reasons why the Word of God really is authoritative for us. Now look at verse 16. He says, we didn't follow cleverly devised myths when we made known to you the power of the coming of the Lord Jesus Christ. Apparently, there's some, just like in our day, that will say, well, don't you know the Word of God is just the word of men? And the Word of God is just a bunch of myths. It's just a bunch of cleverly devised tales. It's really just the product of some men trying to manipulate you and convince you just to believe what they want you to believe, right? No, that's the false teachers. He says, we didn't come to you. It's very similar to 2 Corinthians chapter, I don't remember which chapter, 2 Corinthians, where Paul says, look, false teachers are going to come in with deception and hocus pocus and secretive stuff. Look, Peter says, we didn't come with you with this stuff. We didn't come to you with myths, cleverly devised tales, right? Especially when it surrounds the coming of our Lord Jesus Christ, and we're going to get to that. In fact, once you turn over to chapter 3, look over in chapter 3, maybe you remember that this is what the false teachers are going to say over in chapter 3. They're going to say, where is the coming of the Lord? Look at chapter 3, verse 3. Knowing this, first of all, that scoffers will come in the last days with scoffing, following their own sinful desires. And they will say, where is the promise of His coming? Where is the promise? You say He's coming. Well, where is it? And the world's continuing to say that. Even to us today, Jesus claimed that He was going to come again. The Apostle Peter is going to confirm that in chapter 3. And the world says, oh, you guys just have a bunch of myths. This is never going to happen. Peter says, no. Let me tell you why this Word of God, why you should believe it, all right? Let me give you a couple of reasons here, two reasons, two things why the Word of God is authoritative. Number one is this. The apostolic eyewitness validates authority. Now, it's almost as if Peter's presenting a law, a case of law. Some of you, maybe we've got some lawyers in here. If you go to court and you want to prove your point, it'd be good to have an eyewitness, wouldn't it? Hearsay is not very helpful. But we need an eyewitness. And so what does Peter say? Well, look at it. He says, but we were eyewitnesses of His majesty. Now, notice very carefully the we's here. Who are the we's? The apostles are the we's. The apostles, particularly Peter, James, and John. And he's referring to the Mount of Transfiguration here. But we were eyewitnesses of his majesty. Here is the authority by which we speak. We were eyewitnesses. Eyewitnesses of what? Eyewitnesses of his majesty. Now, real quick, would you flip back with me to Matthew chapter 17? Real quick, if you can, go back to Matthew chapter 17. And I just want to highlight this. What is Peter talking about? What is he referring to? He was referring to the time when himself, Peter, James, and John were on this mountain. And Jesus took them up on the mountain and showed himself to them. And it's almost as if Jesus is, in this scenario, is pulling back his flesh like a curtain. And Peter, James, and John get to look inside and see who this Jesus was. Look at it in chapter 17, verse 1. After 6 days, Jesus took with him Peter, James, and John, his brother, and led them up on a high mountain by themselves. This is Matthew 17, 1. Verse 2 says, and he was transfigured before them. His face shone like the sun, and his clothes became white as light. And behold, there appeared to them Moses and Elijah talking with him. And Peter said to Jesus, Lord, it's good that we're here. If you wish, I will make three tents here, one for you and one for Moses and one for Elijah. And he was still speaking when, behold, a bright cloud overshadowed them. And a voice from the cloud said, this is my beloved Son with whom I am well pleased. Listen to him. When the disciples heard this, they fell on their faces and were terrified. But when Jesus came and touched them, saying, rise and have no fear, when they lifted up their eyes, they saw no one but Jesus only. Now this is the scenario that Peter's talking about. Go back to 2 Peter. He says, we were eyewitnesses. We saw, here are the two things. The apostles saw the majesty of Jesus. Don't you love that word? The majesty. They saw it. They saw this glory of Christ that the Father allowed them to see as the flesh was pulled back, and he saw the shining clothes of Christ glowing. It was just for a moment. It was just for a moment. But the apostles saw firsthand the glory of Jesus. So this word that comes from Jesus is not just any word, right? It is the Word of God. That's what he's saying. Look, we were eyewitnesses. And not only did we see, but we also heard. We heard the voice of God. This is my Son. This is my beloved Son in whom I am well pleased. Nobody else heard it, by the way. Nobody else heard it. The apostles heard it. The apostles saw it. And so we must believe the word of the apostles, the message of the apostles. Back to 2 Peter, verse 17. When he received honor and glory from God, I love that phrase, the Father honored his Son, showed his glory to the disciples, and they saw it, they heard it. Now, that leads to a second point, and this may be the most important part of the whole passage. Not only does the apostolic eyewitness give authority to the Word of God, but secondly, number two, the character of the Word of God validates its authority. Now this next little passage, brothers and sisters, is maybe one of the most important passages. You need to know these passages. And in this little passage, I'm just going to highlight it for just a little bit. We could spend a great deal of time talking about what Peter's saying here. But notice in verse 19, we have the prophetic word more fully confirmed, or as the New American Standard says, a more sure word. A more sure word. Here is this word. I want you to know that the Word of God is a sure word, he says. Calvin says of this little phrase, he says, the authority of the Word of God is the same as it was in the beginning. And then it was given further confirmation than before by the advent of the Lord Jesus Christ. It's not as if now the New Testament is more sure than the old, but now with the coming of Jesus and the resurrection of Jesus, now we know for sure that this Word of God is fully confirmed. fully confirmed. And we can believe it. We can believe it. That's what he's saying. So let me give you three characteristics of this word of God. First, it's a sure word. Number one, it's a sure word. That's what he's telling us. It's a sure word. It's something you can count on. It's the real word of God. Now, think of this with me. How many things in this life can you really put confidence in? How many things can you really put confidence in? Stock market's not confident. Politicians are sure not confident. We're praying, God help us, right? I'm waiting for Jesus to come back. By the way, none of the candidates will help our culture or our country, right? The only one that will help us is the Lord Jesus. So I'm not fearful, and this is an aside. I'm not fearful. Are you fearful? I hope you're not fearful. Listen, God's in control. He's in control. His word is sure. Jesus is coming again. And I don't have to worry about what's happening. Listen, vote your conscience. Pray, ask God to help you. Vote your conscience. Vote the way you feel led to vote, right? But know this, God's in control. And the Lord Jesus is coming again. So I don't have to worry about all these things that are happening. It's a sure word. Jesus is coming again. Number two, it's a shining word. Did you notice what he said? It's a shining word. You'll do well to pay attention to it as a lamp shining in a dark place until the day dawns. I think that's in reference to Christ coming again. Christ is coming again. The day is going to dawn. The morning star rises in your heart. Listen, it's going to be it's a shining word. It's a light under your path. Right? Psalm 19, thy word of God is a lamp unto thy feet, a light unto thy path. It's a shining word. But here's the most important part that Peter wants you to hear. It's a Spirit-given word. Now, this is where we could spend a great deal of time, but I'm just going to highlight this. Notice what Peter says. Knowing this, verse 20, that first of all, no prophecy of Scripture comes from someone's own interpretation. In other words, no one just wrote Scripture. Let me just summarize this for you. No one just wrote it. It wasn't the product of just a man writing it down. But rather, verse 21, for no prophecy was ever produced by the will of men, but men spoke from God as they were carried along by the Holy Spirit. Here's the idea that God, just as the wind would fill the sails of a boat and carry the boat here to there, so God would fill the sails of the apostles, the men who would write Scripture, who were eyewitnesses. God would fill their personalities and fill their minds and lead them to write Scripture. It wasn't a dictation. The Scripture is not a dictation. In fact, we look at Scripture, we see there's personalities in all the different books. But it was the Holy Spirit that was giving us the Word of God. That's what Peter's telling us. The Word of God is the sure word, the shining word. And the word which is given to us by the Holy Spirit, it's the God-breathed word. The God-breathed word. This word. This word. The word of God. Let me make it clear. The written word of God is sure. Not the prophetic word from someone else. I've got some friends who speak prophecy. I want to be nice about this, but that's not a sure word. They say, well, it's not really inerrant. It's not an addition to the Bible, but you know, we need a prophecy here and there, and it's not adding to the sufficiency of Scripture. Well, what is it adding to? And if Scripture is not sufficient, then why do I need a prophetic word? You see, the task of the pastor is to ensure that the congregation is anchored in the Word of God and grounded in the Word of Christ, and that there'll be no further divine light for which the people of God are led than by the Scriptures. That's what Peter's telling us. Listen, don't listen to somebody who's saying they have another word, and you're watching the television. This guy says, well, hey, come over here. I've got something special for you, right? You need to send your money in. You need to sow this word for you. I've got a word. I've got a special something for you. Here's a little something extra to tickle your ears. Listen, don't listen to that. Run from that. Hold on to this. Yes, you say, well, that's the old word. This is all we need is the old word. This is it. We don't need anything else.
Prophecy had the origin in the will of God. The will of God as the Holy Spirit carried them along. This is the doctrine of the inspiration of Scripture. And I'm running out of time. But this is what Peter's telling us. The Word of God alone is authoritative. Why do we need another word? I'll be blunt with you. There's not another word. There's not another word coming. There's not another revelation coming. This is it. So that leads to the third point. Not only do we value the Word of God, not only do we believe the Word of God, but we must pay attention. Number three, pay attention to the Word of God. That's essentially what he says right there in the middle of the passage. Verse 19, and we have a prophetic word more fully confirmed, to which you will do well to pay attention to. Pay attention to the Word of God. Pay attention to it. Wake up. Wake up, Peter says. Listen to it. Obey it. Follow it. Let it be the guide for your life. Let it be the guide for your life. Don't listen to something else. Listen to the Word of God. Let me ask you, how important is the Word of God to you? That's why Peter says you better pay attention to it. Let me ask you, would you have been bothered if we'd have come today to Ebenezer and something other than the Word of God would have been taught? Would that have bothered you? It should bother you. If the Word of God is not being expounded, a ministry without the teaching of the Word of God is a waste of time. Why? Because it's the Word of God which establishes you. It's the Word of God which protects you. It's the Word of God which outlasts you. It's the Word of God that saves us, right? Why would we want anything else? So here's our commitment. We're going to obey the Word of God. And since believing that God has chosen to speak to me through His Word alone, circle that word, alone, I commit to read the Word of God every day. I want you to think about this. Here's my commitment. If all this is true about the Word of God, I'm going to commit to reading it every day with the intent on obeying what God's Word says. If everything that Peter has said is true, then here's my commitment. I'm going to read it as though it is the very Word of God to me. And when I hear it, my intent is to obey it and to follow it. Oh, because you see, it's so valuable to us. It's so valuable. It's so authoritative. It is the sure Word of God. Would you bow your heads with me? Let's pray together. I hope you have this conviction about the Word of God this morning. I hope you know it. I hope you believe it. I hope you trust it. And I hope you'll build your life around this Word of God, which will establish you in the past, protect you in the present, and outlast you. The Word of God. It is a sure Word. Validated by the eyewitnesses of the apostles. Validated by its character, written by the very Spirit of God. This Word is not the words of men alone, but the very Word of God. Do you believe it? Do you trust it? Have you listened to it? Are you obeying it? If not, we beg you, come to Christ today. Come to Christ. Trust Him and trust this Word. There's an element of faith, isn't there, in this? There is an element of faith. We're going to have faith as we trust this Word of God. I hope you know Christ this morning. I hope you know Him. I hope you trust Him. If you don't, we beg you to come to Christ. If you need counsel in any way, come find us. Come find me at the end of the service. Let's make sure that your life is right with the Lord Jesus Christ and that you have eternal life, that you've been established in the faith. Father in heaven, we're thankful for your precious Word. We're thankful that Peter has given us concrete evidences that this Word of God is more than cleverly devised tales of false teachers. This is the true Word of God. And we shouldn't expect a voice from heaven because we have the voice of God written down in this Word. Father, may we be content with your Word. May we be content hearing your Word preached week in, week out, reading it day after day after day. May you help us, guard us from being deceived and listening to the myths and more secret ideas and this and that. Lord, may we just be content with the power of your word. And may Ebenezer, may she continue, Father, week after week, just simply expounding the old, old story, not bringing in new doctrine, something new, but just teaching the true, founded truths of the apostolic word that was confirmed with the eyewitness of Christ and the voice that they heard. Bless this ministry and bless us, Father, as we make a commitment to read your word every day, Lord, that it might establish us, that it might protect us. Lord, we know it's going to outlive us because your word abides forever. So, Father, help us not to hear for another word from another voice. We don't need another voice. We have your word written for us. May we pay close attention to it. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Thanks, Pastor Tim. Well, when we think, and like Pastor Tim said, that God's control in all things, we consider all the worlds his hands have made in this hymn we're going to sing. And we think about the chorus, "Then sings my soul, my Savior, God to thee, how great you are." So let's stand together and let's worship him and consider how great he is.
shall come.
When Christ shall come.
Peter and Yana are in the gym. Please go listen to their ministry. They're all the way here from Russia. Let's encourage them tonight. Corporate prayer meeting. We're going to be doing this on the last Sunday night of every month from here on out. This week we're going to be praying for the election for our country. So won't you come be a part of that this week? And as we leave, let's not forget the Bereans. In Acts chapter 17, as Paul was preaching, it says they examined the scriptures daily to see if these things were true. That's your homework for this week. Study the scriptures. Get in the scriptures and read them. It's God's word to you. Lord bless you. Have a great week. You're dismissed.